Giving you the figures again, they had raised, you said,
About 30,000 that actually went through a caucus funding operation.
Back then for electing and re-electing
in competitive seats,
right?
For competitive seats. And we increased
that. And there really not, had not been that fund before?
I think Bobby established it that year for the first time. The first time I ran, that's not true. I was given about $2,000 out of some fund in Lansing, and it might have been a caucus fund. But I know the year I became speaker, which is was quite a way, they only spent $30,000 the year before that.
Right. And by the time you left, that was
we got up to about 900,000, I think.
Right.
Somewhere in that range.
Yeah.
So that was a major, major change, and it's only just grown from there.
Right. And that was funds raised independent of the whole legislative process, but from the interest groups and so on.
Caucus fundraisers.
Right.
Remember, we had them down at the had the big dinner. We had Mondale as a speaker down at Wren Center,
and
it really took on a much bigger role.
Go back to the race with Joe and Matt McNeely, Joe Forbes, Matt McNeely, those folks. How does a race like that work when you're running against someone else in the caucus, and it's a contested race, and it could be divisive? Then you've got to work together. After that, how does that work out?
Well, it was divisive. It was more on individual personalities than a collective divisive. In other words, there was not a black caucus that was really upset because I got elected speaker, or identifiable body of people. But it was like I had Perry Bullard support, about as liberal as you can get, and I had Mike Griffin, who's probably about as conservative as you could get. I mean, it went across the philosophical lines. It was more on a personality race, which I think is a much easier situation to deal with and to put together. When you got personalities involved in it, those can be corrected in a relatively short period of time. I think if you'd have had strong caucus opposition internally, like, for example, an identifiable group like the Black Caucus, who would be really upset with someone getting like, it would be much, much harder to deal
bring
with.
Together again.
I thought we brought our caucus together, or I brought my caucus together, along with my supporters in a relatively short period of time. I felt like we treated the people who opposed us, like you, fairly. You know, we looked around, I looked at people's skill levels, and made my decisions on committee appointments. There was obviously some commitments that were made during the campaign. I kept those, but I always left myself enough flexibility to make sure that in the end I could pull the caucus back together and appoint the people that I thought could get the job done to the right committees, and we were able to do that.
Right. Now, Joe Forbes wound up as floor leader,
right.
So you had a working relationship that worked well.
Yeah, Joe and I don't think ever had any personal animosity against one another. In fact, Joe and I probably got along better than anyone during that race as individuals, collectively. There was a lot of our supporters that got a lot more upset than Joe and I did. As you know, Joe's personality.
Yes.
A real funny guy, easy guy to work with, not a real intense person, I don't think. And probably the intensity was on my side versus Joe. We got along very, very well. And then when Blanchard came in, and you know, the governor was basically told by John Dingell and Bill Ford and those people that he had to stay out of that race, that he couldn't get involved in the speaker's race. He just got elected. And in fact, we had a meeting with him, and both Dingell and Ford made it very, very clear to him that that would be unacceptable for him to get involved in the speaker's election. And Joe was very close to the governor. Very close friend of his.
What was the year?
72.
No, the year of the speaker's 82.
Yeah, I've been 82.
Okay.
Yeah, because I left in 88, so 6 years ago.
So you became speaker, coincidentally, with Blanchard becoming governor.
Right.
So you immediately were confronted with a budget crisis.
We had a budget crisis. We had a new governor, new leaders in the Senate.
The Senate was Democratic at
Democratic.
That point.
Bill Faust was a leader, very close friend of mine, had been my senator, state senator. So to start off with, I always felt Bill Faust was one of the better politicians in Lansing, and most people who knew him would agree with that. He was a very likable guy. He was handicapped from a car accident. and was in a wheelchair, but Bill was a very, very effective politician, a very good politician. And he was the leader of the Senate, and I was leader of the House, and we were very, very close personal friends. So, you know, that part was very, very good to start off with that. The difficulty was the governor coming in, bringing different people, you know, they're replacing a Republican who'd been there, I think, 12 years, or I think Milliken had been there 12 years, maybe even longer. And so a whole new administration of new people coming in with new ideas and new ways of doing things. But the experience was in the legislature. I mean, the Democrats had controlled the legislative process for a long time. People like Bill Ryan and Bobby Crimm were still there. I think Ryan might have moved on before that. I can't remember. And Bobby had too. Mm-hmm. Bobby had left because I replaced Bobby, so he left. I'm sure Ryan had left as well. Mm-hmm. But you had people who'd been in the legislature for 10, 15, 20 years, 30 years, and been in control. So they were set in their ways. They knew what the responsibilities were. They knew how the process worked. And then you had a governor who basically had never been to Lansing. Other than just on...
he had served in Congress, before. Mm-hmm. How well did you know him, Governor Blanchard?
Not at all. I mean, I met him during the campaign, obviously, and I supported him and worked for him, but up until that time, I didn't know him.
Mm-hmm. And he had... There was strain between him and the caucus for the reasons you're describing. Essentially, the caucus had been the Democratic voice up to that point during a Republican administration. So there was some tension there?
Yeah, I think so. I think the recognized leader of the Democrat Party in Michigan was Bill Ryan and Bobby Crimm and those type of people. He had strong speakers. And there were Frank Kelly, who was Attorney General, and Don Riegel, I think, was United States Senator in 11. But really, people looked to Lansing for leadership and looked to the Democrats for leadership. The speaker was, at that time, probably the most powerful Democrat in the state.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The talk about how you got to know Blanchard then. How did that relationship develop?
You know, the governor, Governor Blanchard always made it an effort. The good thing about him coming from Washington was he had a lot of respect for the leadership. And that's part of being a congressman, I guess. You know, the speaker is a speaker, and he had a lot of respect for that. He made it very clear to me from day one that I would call the shots in the caucus, that he was not going to be in a caucus undermining me in any way, and nor would anyone who worked for him. And he kept that commitment the whole 8 years that I, 6 years I was speaker. The governor pretty much stayed out of caucus politics and left that up to me. And I appreciated that because, you know, you can be undermined pretty easy in that process. And I remember one of the presidents said, you know, told me one day, he said, Mr. Speaker, he says, I got 2 or 3 people meeting to get rid of me every day. And I said, I got 10 or 20 meeting to get rid of me every day. So, you know, it's a little different. And I said, welcome to the world. But I had a good working relationship with Blanchard. I think he respected the leadership that was in the legislature. I don't think he ever established close enough personal ties with members of the caucus that he should have. A part of that may have been his commitment to not get involved in caucus politics and not be overshadowed the leadership. I never understood why he didn't develop better relationships with more legislators than what he did.
All right. The budget situation that was the state was facing at that point. As I recall, Blanchard, as governor, convened or commissioned a group of people to come up, a bipartisan group, to come up with solutions for the budget process problem. And among those was a proposal to increase the income tax. I don't know if that came from that commissioner, but at least that became his recommendation. Yeah. So that was on your plate almost immediately as you became speaker.
And yours, if you remember correctly. That. We were already working at the time that commission was on the income tax, preparing it and trying to figure out how it was going to impact and looking at it politically. So when the governor pro-